purpose in which we've gathered to install Chris Findley as the new rector of St. Patrick's. So I invite you to join with me with the opening acclamation found on page 3 of your service bulletin. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Together, Almighty God, to you
all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Congregation may be seated. Dearly beloved, we've assembled in the presence of God for the purpose of instituting the new rector of this congregation.
Reverend Father and God, on behalf of St. Patrick's Church, we present Christopher Gresham Findley to be instituted as rector. We believe that he is well qualified and has been perfectly and lawfully selected.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Father Jack King, who is the Dean of the Tennessee Convocation, if he would read the letter of institution.
The Reverend Christopher Gresham Findley, Presbyter of the Church of God, we hereby install and institute you as Rector of St. Patrick's Anglican Church, Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and we give you full power and authority to carry out the ministry of rector of this congregation, performing those duties as prescribed by the Constitution and canons of the Anglican Church in North America and the Anglican Diocese of the South. We pray that Almighty God will enable you to fulfill this sacred responsibility. Heed the words of Holy Scripture. Shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. We hereby reserve to the Bishop of the Anglican Diocese of the South and his successors full power and authority to revoke these presents whenever under the canons he shall have just cause to do so. Given under my hand and seal in the city of Murfreesboro, Tennessee, on the 22nd day of November, in the year of our Lord, 2020, and in the 11th year of our Archbishop's consecration.
I, Christopher Gresham Findley, receive this letter from your hands and recognize your episcopal authority. I promise to be a faithful shepherd to your flock, the Lord being my helper.
Let us then offer our prayers to God for all his people, for this congregation, and for Chris, their rector.
Now to be admitted to the order of priests and to pour your grace upon him, that he may duly execute Church, and to the glory of your holy name.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That it may please you to guide by your indwelling Spirit those whom you call to the ministry of your Church, that they may go forth with courage and persevere to the end.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That it may please you to increase the number of ministers in your Church, that the gospel may be preached to all people.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That it may please you to grant us true repentance, amendment of life, and the forgiveness of all our sins.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That it may please you to hasten the fulfillment of your purpose, and your Church may be one.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
That it may please you to grant that we, with all your saints, may be partakers of your everlasting kingdom.
We beseech you to hear us, good Lord.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Hear us, O Lord, when we cry out to you.
Have mercy upon us and hear us.
O Lord, arise and help us.
And deliver us for your name's sake.
Let your priests be clothed with righteousness.
And let your saints sing with joy.
O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come to you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Most gracious Father, the giver of all good and perfect gifts, in your wise providence you appoint leaders for the mission of your Church. Give grace to Chris, your servant, to whom the charge of this congregation is now given. So empower him with the truth of sound doctrine and endue him with holiness of life, that he may faithfully serve you to the glory of your great name and the benefit of your holy Church. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You be seated for the reading.
A reading from Joshua. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts, according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
As the Archbishop and Primate of the Anglican Church in North America and also the Bishop of the Diocese of the South, it is a joy to be back at St. Patrick's and to be part of this special occasion installing Chris as the new rector. I want to say also to Cheryl and Aiden and Evan and Caitlin, thank you. You are in our prayers as well. Thank you for your willingness to share him with all of us in this special role. Father Chris, I've often wondered what to say to folks on this occasion because it's very exciting, yet very challenging, especially in the season in which we now find ourselves. Now, Jesus said on the night that he was betrayed and the day that he gave his life for us, the night before he died on the cross for our sins. He's with all his disciples and he gives them this charge in John chapter 15, which we just heard read. As the Father has loved me, he said, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than someone lay down his life for his friends. This is my commandment, he said, that you love one another as I have loved you. So we must ask, how did Jesus love us? And I want to offer some suggestions for you to consider tonight. First, he shared himself. We call it the incarnation. He shared himself. In John chapter 1, verse 14, we hear this. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We've seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father full of grace and truth. 1 John 4, 9 says this. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. He shared himself. He set aside his glory. He set aside his majesty. He set aside the fullness of the deity and entered into our world as one of us. He became a human being, fully God and fully man at the same time. How did Jesus love us? He shared himself by coming into our world, by being born as a baby, growing up and living like us humans. How do we love like Jesus loved? We do the same thing. We share ourselves with others. We enter into their worlds, whether it's a spouse or a friend or a parent or a child or unbelievers. We leave the comfortableness of our world and we go into theirs. We leave our glory. We go humble ourselves and enter into their world. Too many marriages have homes with people that pass each other like ships in the night. They see each other, and that's a maybe, but then they don't share. They don't enter into each other's worlds. Too many friendships are like two computers talking to each other. They may be connected, but they don't enter into each other's space. Too many attempts to share Jesus with others is rooted in an expectation that the other come to us. But like Jesus, love is expressed when we leave our world, our culture, our network of friends, and enter into others' worlds and share their lives in their place. So, Father Chris,
As a priest, Jesus calls you to leave your office and your study and your prayer closet and go out to where people are. Go to where they live and where they work and where they play. It's like going fishing. For those of you who like to fish, do you expect the fish to just jump in your boat? No. You have to go where the fish are. You got to put the bait down there where they are. Jesus shared himself, and so must we. Love one another as I've loved you. How has he loved us? Secondly, Jesus served. He served. He taught. He did miracles. He traveled great distances by walking. He washed his disciples' feet. Jesus said it this way in Mark 10:45. He said, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve." Now, I know this may sound strange to our modern ear, but real love is about the other person. It's not about you. It's about the other person. Jesus modeled serving others. I remember a parishioner years ago telling me that she'd had a busy and very rough day. And when she got home, her husband had her sit down in her favorite chair, prop her feet up on the cushions, and he massaged her feet. He then cooked dinner and provided her with a calm and peaceful evening. He served her. As Christians, we're called to serve by expressing the love of Jesus. Chris, being the rector doesn't mean that we expect people to serve us. It means we serve them. It means we give to them. When I was a rector, I would park in the furthest parking place so others, especially our old-timers, wouldn't have to walk so far. Small thing, but it's an act of service. I mean, I know there are many places where you've got the pastor's special parking place right by the door. You know, I'm not putting that down, so to speak, but what I'm trying to say is we're called to serve them, not them serve us. A question I always have to ask myself, even as a bishop, and even as the Archbishop, am I a self-serving leader or a serving leader? Am I a self-serving leader or a serving leader? Is it about me or is it about the people I'm called to serve? Jesus served, and so must we. Love one another as I've loved you. How has Jesus loved us? He shared himself. He served. Thirdly, he sacrificed himself. We call this the atonement. In 1 John 4:10, the apostle writes, "This is love, not that we loved God, but that he sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." Romans 5:8 says this, "But God demonstrates his own love for us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Jesus displayed his love for all humanity, and that he went to the cross for us. He sacrificed himself so that we might have forgiveness of our sins. He sacrificed himself so that you and I could have a relationship with Almighty God. He sacrificed himself so we didn't have to. But this is love. As Jesus said in John 15:13, "Greater love has no one than this, than someone laid down his life for his friends." So how do we love one another as Jesus loved us? We sacrifice for others. We pick up our cross daily and follow Jesus. That is, we die to self and we live for God. We sacrifice our selfishness and our self-centeredness. As Paul said to the Galatians in Galatians 2:20, "I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me, who loved me and gave himself for me." If you're a parent, you sacrifice for your kids, and you often do this without thinking about it. You do it because you love your kids. You do what you have to do for them. Well, what about for members of the body of Christ, your brothers and sisters in the Lord? Father Chris, as rector, you are called to sacrifice, to pick up your cross daily and follow Jesus. I don't think you'd be here tonight if you didn't understand that to some degree. We're all called to sacrifice for the sheep. So to love one another as I've loved you. How has Jesus loved us? He shared himself, he served, he sacrificed. And then number four, he was steadfast. He was steadfast. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, verse and 3 says this: Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand on the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. He was steadfast in his call. He was committed. He was dedicated. He was unwavering. He was set on his course and he did not turn back. He persevered to the end. He was steadfast. And this is another aspect of love. I think too many of us have bought into this love is a feeling concept or philosophy that our culture tells us about love. If I feel love, I love. If I don't feel love, I don't love. If I fall in love, I get married. If I fall out of love, I get divorced. Well, 1 Corinthians tells us that love is something that we do regardless of how we feel. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious. Love does not rejoice in evil. Love always, and it gives all these always, and love never fails. You see, love is so much more than a feeling. It's commitment. It's dedication. It's steadfast. Father Chris, as rector, you will be called to remain steadfast in the mission God has given you. You'll be tempted to forget the gospel message. You will be tempted to ignore the great commandment and the great commission. You'll be tempted to not keep the main thing, which is Jesus. You'll be tempted to allow power and influence and finances to take you away from the mission of your calling. Jesus was steadfast, and that's one of the ways he loved us. So he shared himself, he served, he sacrificed, and he was steadfast. As Jesus said, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." So let us go and do likewise. Let us pray. Father, thank you for your servant Chris, and as he seeks to follow you in this place and serve as your shepherd of these sheep, I pray that he would manifest your love in all its many facets, that you'd be able to say to him one day, "My good and faithful servant," because he is loved and loved and loved as you've loved us. And this is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father.
Congregation to be seated, and ask Father Chris if he'd come stand in front here. Let the symbols of this office now be presented.
Chris, preach the word at all times, and let our worship and our life together manifest the grace and truth of this book.
Amen. Amen.
Chris, be a man of prayer and use this book to build us up as living stones of a holy temple.
Amen.
Chris, be a teacher of the faith, making disciples who make disciples.
Amen.
Chris, receive these keys, and let the doors of this place be open to all, that many would come to know the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ.
Amen. Those are some keys. Hold those up.
Chris, obey these canons and be among us to share in the councils of this diocese.
Chris, receive this water and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them obedience of our Lord.
Amen.
Chris, let all these symbols be signs of the ministry which is the Lord's and ours in this place. Amen.
O Lord my God, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, yet you have called your servant to stand in your house and to serve at your altar. To you and to your service I devote myself, body, soul, and spirit. Fill my memory with the record of your mighty works. Enlighten my understanding with the light of your Holy Spirit. And may all the desires of my heart and will center in what you would have me do. Make me an instrument of your salvation for the people entrusted to my care, and grant that I may faithfully preach the gospel and administer your holy sacraments, and by my life and teaching set forth your true and living word. Be always with me in carrying out the duties of my ministry. In prayer, quicken my devotion. In praises, heighten my love and gratitude. In preaching, give me readiness of thought and expression. In worship, increase my zeal for godly preparation, and grant that by the clearness and brightness of your holy word, all the world may be drawn into your blessed kingdom. All this I ask for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Chris, we stand. Cheryl, would you come forward? There you are. Okay. I thought you were in the back. Well, let's welcome your new rector and his sweet bride. So before I ask you if you want to say anything, let me just give another word to you guys. Please pray for them daily. Please care for them. Please help them. Please serve them. I know a lot of you guys are football fans, and if you know somebody's sitting on the sideline of the other team, you don't care about them, right? But as soon as they get on the field, somebody's got your number. But when you're the quarterback or you're the leader of the team, guess what? Everybody has your number. And guess what? People are going to try to have his number. And you guys really need to pray for him and her, because it's just such an important role they have, but the enemy would... But he loves to try to attack. And so we need you guys to support them and love them. Can you do that?
Amen.
So you want to say anything, sir?
Just thanks to all of you for entrusting me with this. And I'm grateful to be here. Thank you for walking this road. And really appreciate just being a part of St. Patrick's. And I appreciate... just the love that you've shown us for these last 8 years, and look forward to where we're going.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us
Let's greet one another socially distanced. Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you. Partakers of his most blessed body and blood. he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of your dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, your humble servants, celebrate and make here before your divine majesty, with these holy gifts, the memorial your Son commanded us to make, remembering his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and his promise to come again. And we earnestly desire your fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, asking you to grant that by the merits and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice. We humbly pray that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with your grace and heavenly benediction, and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And although we are unworthy because of our many sins to offer you any sacrifice, yet we ask you to accept this duty and service we owe, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ, our Lord. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord,
trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs of your table, but you are the same Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may have more blood on him, and he in us. Amen.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us your peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold he who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Almighty God, you have built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant that by the operation of the Holy Spirit, all Christians may be joined together in unity of spirit and the bond of peace, that they may be a holy temple acceptable to you. Give the abundance of your grace, especially to this congregation, that with one heart we may desire the help and increase of your holy church, with one voice profess the faith once delivered to the saints. Defend us from the sins of heresy and schism, and grant that the course of this world may be so peaceably ordered by your governance, that your church may joyfully serve you in all godliness and faithfully walk in the ways of truth and peace, so that on the day of judgment, we all may be numbered with your saints in glory everlasting. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, the gracious shepherd and bishop of our souls, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end.
Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thanks be to God.